Hari Om. So let us start with a prayer to Saraswati, okay? Ayatu Varada Devi Aksharam Brahma Samhitam Gayatri Chandasam Mata Idam Brahma Jushasvanaha. Hari Om. The meaning of this verse is, let Ayatu, let that goddess Saraswati come here, okay? And how is she? She is Chandasam Mata. She is the mother of all the Vedas, the Vedic literature. So let her come here and let her rejoice the Brahma, the prayer which we are offering to her. Idam Brahma Jushasva. Jushasva, enjoy or rejoice. Okay? So let Ma Saraswati come here today in the class and enjoy whatever I am going to tell. And she is Chandasam Mata, and I'm referring to a narrative from Chandas, that is the Veda, Rigveda, which is a very famous myth of Indra and Vritra fight, so to say. So before turning to that, let us see who is Indra and who is Vritra. What is the etymology of Indra, Vritra and others? Okay. So Vedic Indra, as I told in the last few lectures perhaps, in the Rigveda, 1/4 of the Rigveda is dedicated to the prayers of Lord Indra. Almost 250 hymns, okay, out of 1028 hymns, 250. That's a huge number. That is alone for Lord Indra. So the most popular deity, his main activity is killing Vritra and releasing the waters, okay, the rain waters. He is the showerer of rains. And he is assisted in this task by his assistants, so to say, which are called Maruts, the wind gods. Maruts, Maruta, that is wind god, okay? The storm gods or the wind gods. Additionally, his main activity is killing Vritra and releasing waters. Additionally, whatever is heroic, whatever is adventurous, that is ascribed to Indra. And there is a quotation in Nirukta, the primeval sort of text on the science of etymology as such. Atha asya karma, rasa anupradanam, rasa anupradanam, releasing waters, vritra vadhaha cha, and killing vritra. And yakacha balakritihi, indra karma eva tat. Whatever is adventurous, whatever is mighty, a deed of might, that is all assigned to Indra. Now let us see the etymology. This is the explanation of his heroic exploits, right? So let us see the etymology word by word, you know. Indra, it is Inda and Ra, Ira, there is the letter E, phoneme E, I mean, the Uccharana, Ikara is there, Rakara is there, Nakara is there, Dakara is there. So these are the four phonemes which we hear. Now, according to Nirukta, this is given by Yaskamuni, Indraha Iram Dranati, Dranati, Dadati, Dranati is tear apart, okay? Break or tear apart. Dadati gives, Dadati holds, Dharayate, again it's a causal of Dranati, and Dharayate, causal of Dadati, that is to hold. And Ira is either Prithivi, the earth, or the food which is produced by Mother Earth. We are familiar with the name Iravati, right? Iravati is Mahi or Prithivi. Why? Irayukta, Vati, Vat is a possessive suffix. So one who possesses food, one who gives food, that is Iravati, that is Mother Earth. Now he being the rain god as such, not exactly Parjanya, but the officer who sends Parjanya, the officer who sends showers on the earth, okay? He is the controller of all the showers. So Ira is Vrihadi Annam, that could be the food, Vrihi, that is the rice, okay? Vrihadi Annam, paddy. Ira Daraha, the explanation is given as Ira Daraha, Indraha, one who gives food by showering rains. Food can be produced only when there are rains, right? Then another etymology is given as Indave Dravati Ramate Itiva. Indu is commonly told as a drop of the Soma juice. Indu in the post-Vedic literature means moon, right? Indu, Indave Namaha. Indu means moon, and therefore Indumati is night. Indumati is night, which has moon. Okay? So, Indave Dravati Ramate Itiva, he is the lover of Soma juice. And therefore, wherever there is Soma pounding going on, he just listens to the voice and rushes there with the desire to have Soma juice. Okay? So, on that, there is a sukta in the 8th mandala of the Rig Veda. It is Indra Apala Sukta. Apala. Sometime later, I'll talk about it. Another, third etymology given is Indhe Bhutani Itiva. He kindles the beings by giving them food. Indhe, Indhana, Indhana, kindle, enkindle, okay, Indhana. So Indhe Bhutani, he kindles all beings. That is, he sustains, he nourishes all the beings, and therefore he is called Indra. So this is about Indra. Now we come to the next Vritra. Vritro Vrunoterva Vartaterva Vardhaterva. Again, there are three etymologies given for the word Vritra. Okay, Vritra is one who covers the sky. Vritra is cloud. Cloud covers the sky, and therefore he is called Vritra. Vartaterva Vritu Gatau. In the Vedic literature, Vritra is Gatyarthaka root. It gives you gait or motion. So he moves in the sky, he wanders in the sky, the cloud, you know, wanders in the sky. And Vardhate Itiva, the cloud swells with the rainwater. In the rainy season, it swells with the raining water, it grows big. Vardhate grows big. Tat Ko Vritraha, again a very interesting dialogue in the Rigveda, in the Nirukta. Tat Ko Vritraha, who is Vritra? Megha iti Nairuktaha. It is a cloud according to the etymologist. But according to the historians, according to the legendist, so to say, Tvashtraha Asuraha iti Aitihasikaha. This is not just a statement from the Nirukta. I would rather say these are the different interpretations of the same thing. As old as 7th century before the Common Era, this work has been compiled. This is not just a original work, this is a commentary on Nighantu, right? So this is a compilation, but interpretation of that. So Ko Vritraha Megha iti Nairuktaha. According to the etymological meaning, the grammatical meaning, that perspective, it gives the meaning of a cloud. If you apply the historical approach, you know, there are historical approach, philosophical approach, sociological approach and whatnot. So all these approaches are there, different perspectives. So according to Aitihasika, the legendist or the historians, Tvashtraha Asuraha. He is an asura, he is a demon, the son of Tvashta. Tvashta happens to be the architect of the gods. He is the architect of the gods, okay? Like a Maya, Mayasura, you have in the Mahabharata. Similarly, he is Tvashta in the Vedic period. So, Tvashtraha Asuraha, so it's a humanization. It's a personization, okay? Personification. Then Indra becomes a person. Then Vritra becomes a person, a demonic figure, and they have a fight. Okay? So, that is the meaning. But in general, the etymological interpretation, which is obviously favored by Yaskamuni because he is writing a scripture on etymology, he says, Apamcha Jyotishascha. Jyotish is the light. Appas is water. Mishri Bhava Karmanaha. The water vapors, you know, the water get evaporated by the heat of the sun. Then it goes in the air. It is carried by the winds, you know, the dust particles, etc. also gathered together, and then the cloud is formed. How clouds are formed? Dhuma Jyotis Salila Marutam Sannipataha, says Kalidasa in his Meghaduta. Similarly here, apamcha jyotishascha mishri bhava karmanaha varsha karma jayate. So that is the natural phenomenon of a rain phenomenon. It is tatra upamarthena yuddhavaranaha bhavanti. It's only metaphorically that yuddha, a fight between Indra and Vritra, they are imagined to be. So that was Vritra. Who is Vritra? Now Indra and Vritra, what is their fight? Indra is called Vritraha or Vritrahan, one who kills Vritra. With what does he kill Vritra? With Vajra. And therefore Indra has a name Vajrin or Vajranga or Vajrayudha, Vajrapani. Okay? And then Vajranga became Bajranga. You know, one who is as mighty as Vajra. And then Bajranga Bali ki Jai, it was assigned to Hanumanji. But basically Vajra is lightning, okay? So Vritra is known as Ahi. Ahi is a serpent, a snake. Ahi is a serpent. Dragon in the Veda. Yo hatva ahim arinat sapta sindhun. It's from the Rig Veda. The next line is also from the Rig Veda. Ahim indro jaghana. Indraha ahim jaghana killed. And in the second mandala of the Rig Veda, hatva ahim, after killing the snake, the dragon, arinat released sapta sindhun, seven streams of water. Sapta is not necessarily 6 plus 1. It is many. It's not just limited to 7. It is many. So he released many streams of water. That means rain started showering and there were streams flowing all over the world. A terrible fiend, Vritra, is a terrible enemy who amassed all the waters of the world into himself and he caused drought. And therefore, people were not getting water. And therefore, Indra had to kill and release the water, which was, you know, held captive, so to say, in the belly of the cloud, in the belly by Vritra. Later on, Vritra became a general name for any enemy. But Vritra is a particular enemy, then it becomes a generic name, more or less. Vritra is Ahi, I said. It's a dragon, okay? In the narrative literature, dragon is a reptile, sometimes having wings, sometimes having multiple claws, okay, and multiple organs. Dragons, serpents, cloud, elephants, mountains, what is common in all that? There won't be anything common for us. But see, the Brahmanda Purana quotation is here. Gajanam, elephants, Parvatanam, mountains, Meghanam, clouds, Bhogi Bhihi Saha. Bhoga is the phata, the hood. Bhogin is a serpent who has hood, a hooded snake. Okay? Bhogibhisa along with the serpents. Kulamekam yonireka. Their kula is one. Their yoni, their source is one. That is jalam. So everything comes from jala. So what is common in so very distinct these phenomena, dragon, serpent, cloud, elephant and mountain, that is, all are connected with water, emerging from it and controlling water. Emerging from the water and controlling the water, that is the common aspect in all these. Now, going ahead again with the dragon thing, Vritra is a dragon, we said. In the narrative literature again, he is a reptile, sometimes having wings, claws, etc., we saw. And they are closely associated with each other. And therefore, if you remember in Kalidasa's Meghaduta, you know, Megha is likened with a cloud, with a mountain. Ashadhasya prathamadivase meghamashlishtasanum vaprakrida parinata gajaprekshaniyam dadarsha. He is likened with an elephant. He is likened with a mountain. So it's all commonly ascribed to them. Again, there is another story, but when I tell about Meghaduta, I'll tell about that. So that is the Kulamekam Jalam Smritam, Yonireka Jalam Smritam. He is called Ahi. I told you he is called Ahi. Now, what is the meaning of Ahi? Again, there comes etymology. Eti in Gatau, that is the root. Every word, Yaska says, has to be derived from one or the other root verb. Tatra namani akhyata jani. Akhyata is a verb. Tatra namani akhyata jani is the fundamental principle of Nirukta. And therefore, every word he tries to derive from some or the other root. So here the root is ahi eti antarikshe, that is the root. Ahihi eti antarikshe. Yaha ahihi saha buddhnyaha. Buddhna means antariksha, the mid region, okay, the atmospheric region. Buddhna. One who is born in Buddhna is called Buddhnya. Buddhne bhavaha iti buddhnyaha. It's a tadvita. And therefore, yaha ahihi saha buddhnyaha. Ahir buddhnyaha. Ahir buddhnya happens to be one of the devata in the Rigveda. Devata is not, as I told in the first few lectures perhaps, devata doesn't mean like Rama, Vishnu, Shiva, Durga and all. Devata is for whom that hymn is ascribed, that becomes the devata of the hymn. Okay? As simple as that. Yamuddishya. That is the devata. Now, hero Indra killed that Vritra and released the treasured waters. This is a natural phenomenon we saw. It is Mishri Bhava Karmanaha Varsha Karma Jayate. Through in the distant atmosphere, there is the rumbling of the clouds. There flashes the lightning with the strong wind and thundering and all. Flash of lightning, and then there are showers. That flash of lightning is the Vajra in the hand of Indra. He smashes, he strikes that cloud, you know, who amasses the water. And with that Vajra, he breaks the belly apart and the waters are released. When it's torrentially, it's raining, you know, cats and dogs, it's raining. For that, this is given. Whenever there is in distance some rumbling happening, then there is this flash of lightning. And then Indra striking Vritra with the Vajra, that is the lightning flash. Metaphorically told as the fight between Indra and Vritra. So Ahi is the enemy of Indra, as we saw. Now, as we have this Indra-Vritra fight in the Rigveda and after the Rigveda in the post-Vedic literature, in Indian literature as well as in the world literature, we find many such narratives, many such myths which can be compared with the Indra-Vritra myth. In the Rigveda itself, before Indra performs this adventure of killing Vritra by lightning, there is another god which was overshadowed by Indra later on by his heroic deeds. There is another overshadowed god is Varuna. In the Rigveda itself, Varuna was overshadowed by Indra. So Trita Aptya, and or it is called Trishiras or Vishwarupa. Trishiras having three heads. Three heads. Now, Trita, there were three sons like Ekata, Dvita and Trita. I have an article on this which is published in the Oriental Institute of Baroda. I'll give you, I can share with you that article. So, Trita, there were three brothers, okay, Ekata, Dvita and Trita. Ekata and Dvita, they did not give the due share, the rightful share to the youngest brother, Trita. You know, that is the story. And same pattern gets, you know, in multiple times, in multiple granthas, sastras, we have the same story. So Trita fought the serpent-bodied, three-headed and six-eyed dragon and freed the cattle. Here it is not the rain, the water, here it is cattle. Interestingly, it is in the Vedic literature, it is stated in the form of he released the cows. Now, the cows could be the phenomenal cows, the animal, quadruped, okay, having 4 feet and all. They could be water cows or they could be light cows. Light cows, the rays of the sun. The cloud also covers the sun and the rays can't reach, okay. And when the cloud gets removed, the rays of the sun can reach there. So, that is also, any obstruction is a vritra. And anything released, whether it is light rays or the water or the cattle, this is the heroic adventure of the mortal man Indra, who was later on deified into Indra the deity. Now Trita is the third, Trita, the third person, killing the three-headed dragon. Is there anything like sympathetic magic, we call it? In Atharva Veda, we have such sympathetic magical formulae. Okay, sympathetic magical formulae. When we'll deal with Atharva Veda, maybe I can tell you more about it. So it could be a sympathetic magic, the third number and killing the three-headed person, three-headed demon. Now Trita apparently is a Rigvedic seer also, and he has composed 8 hymns in the Rigveda, especially in the 9th mandala. I told you last lecture perhaps that 9th mandala is known as Pavamana mandala because it is entirely dedicated to Soma. Okay, Soma is Pavamana. Okay, so Trita is the seer of the 8 hymns and he is a preparer of celestial Soma. Why I am telling you in this detail is, similar story we find in Zend Avesta of Zoroastrian literature. And there the Trita is called Tretona Atvya instead of Aptya. Okay, Tretona Atvya. So we'll come to that. And there also the Trita is associated with Homa, H-A-O-M-A, that is Rigvedic Soma. So many similarities are there. Now we come to the stylization as a feature. This whole story, I feel, is a stylization. It's a pattern. It indicates a pattern to you. And you can change the places, you can change the names, but the pattern remains the same. So wherever you go, the pattern will remain the same. So that is the stylization. In the narrative literature, we normally find some style, some structure. So this is a structuralism, so to say, okay, of Claude Lévi-Strauss and so many other people are there. Hero fighting a dragon and releasing treasure is a structural pattern. What is the structure? Hero fighting some dragon, some demon, and releasing something, somebody. Either he releases the treasure in the form of waters or light or cows, or he releases a maiden, a damsel in distress. So that's also treasure. The treasure could be water, light, precious gems, or a maiden in the enclosure of a dragon or a demon. In the folklore, it is precious gems or a maiden. Normally, in the folklore, it is gems or a maiden. This pattern is seen in other ancient mythologies. So we'll see that. An inevitable part of stylization is improvisation to keep the interest intact. Everything will not be copied, like, you know, from one mold, something is taken out, all look alike. It's not like that. There will be some variations here and there to keep the interest intact of the readers. Okay. So that is normally, that facility is given in the for the improvisation. Okay. In our own Puranic story, the post-Vedic literature, Vishnu sleeping on the Shesha, again a serpent, and multi-headed, multiple heads the Shesha has, Sheshanaga. It's as if subjugating a dragon. And again that Shesha is in the Kshirasagara, so the connection of water. Connection of water, connection of serpent, and Vishnu, who is Upendra. In the Veda, it is Indra. Another name for Vishnu in the Puranic literature, in the post-Vedic literature, is Upendra. Upa Indra is a deputy Indra. So whatever Indra could not do, he got it done from his deputy, Upendra, Vishnu. In the Rigveda, we have only 6 hymns. As against 250 to Indra, for Vishnu, there are only 6. Only 6 hymns are there. So he is subordinate deity that way. But in the Puranic literature, where is Indra? Nowhere. And we have only Vishnu and Shiva and other gods, right? So this is a transformation. One god transforms into other. So this is Vishnu sleeping on the Shesha, is subjugating the multi-headed snake in a way. Krishna dancing on Kaliya. Kaliya is a snake. He can't be exactly compared with Vritra, but see, Vritra also controlled the water. He amassed the water. And here Kaliya, what did he do? In the Bhagavata, we have this. in the 10th skandha, right? The story of Kaliya Marvana. What did Kaliya do? He did not allow the Gokula people to have a dip in the water or drink the water. There was nobody, no aquatic being in that Kalindi river, because it was all venomous and poisonous because of Kaliya. In a way, he controlled all that water and it was not being used by anyone else. So when Krishna drove him away, he did not kill him. Kaliya, he drove him away, but released those waters for the benefit of the people. So Krishna driving him away, releasing the waters from the venom and favoring the cowherd boys of Gokula, that was also release of water and driving away. There is a fight of Krishna and Kaliya. Okay, 1,000 heads of Kaliya, 1,000 hoods of Kaliya. So this is a great activity of community service. What Indra did was, the amassed water was released for the benefit of the people. Krishna also did the same thing. Now in the other mythologies, we have this. Other ancient mythologies, when we talk about ancient mythologies, the Greek mythology, the Mesopotamian mythology, the Iranian mythology, they are as old or little later than the Indian, the Rigvedic mythology, we can say. So other ancient mythologies we have, for example, in the Greek mythology, Apollo, the greatest god, as there is Indra in the Rigveda, in the Greek mythology, it is Apollo. So Apollo fighting the python. Python is the Ajagara. That's a snake. Python is the Ajagara. So he fighting that. Hydra, there is another name. Python name is there, Typhon is there, and Hydra is there. Hydra. Hydra is hydro, I mean, associated with water, right? So Hydra is snake-like dragon associated with water, whom Apollo killed. Then we come to the Mesopotamian mythology. The Middle East, the Central Asia, we can say. The Central Asia part, the Turkey, the Syria part today, you know. The Mesopotamia, Babylonia, Akkadia, Sumeria. So the Sumerian mythology, Akkadian mythology, like that. They are all like Tigris-Euphrates rivers. This was supposedly the cradle of ancient civilization, as it was in Sindhu Saraswati river civilization. So Marduk is the hero. And I was intending to write a paper, I could not do it. Maybe I'll do it sometime later. Marduk and Maruts. Is there any, like, not just phonetic similarity, but the feat which they achieve, you know, the adventure which they do is similar. So Marduk is the storm god. Again, he is the storm god, functionally also. It's not only phonetic similarity, there is a functional similarity between Marduk and Maruts of the Rigveda. So he is the storm god fighting Tiamat. Tiamat is a demoness. It is she, not he, for a change. For a change, the demoness, it is not a demon he, it's a she. She is the salt sea goddess. She is the salt sea goddess. Okay. There is a sweet sea also. I mean, sweet reservoir of water that has another god. And this is a salt sea goddess in the form of a winged dragon. She also comes in the form of a winged dragon, and Marduk fights her and releases the water. Okay. So that is the Greek and the Mesopotamian mythology. We come to the Iranian mythology. Now this Iranian hero, he is called Azi Dahaka. Can you read the name here? Azi Dahaka. Azi. Azi is Ahi. Azi is Ahi. And Dahaka is Dashaka. Dashaka, the biting snake. Ahi Dashaka. That is as good as Vrutra, the Ahi. Okay, Iranian hero fights the dragon Azi Dahaka, Ahi Dashaka, the biting serpent. It is also three-headed. See, there are three heads, one, two, and three, and two eyes each. So six eyes. So three-headed, six-eyed, and that is in their Yasna. Yasna is the ritual mantra-like thing, you know, that is called Yasna and Yashta. In Zen Avesta, we find this. In the Sacred Books of the East series, edited by general editor is Max Müller, you have the translation of Zen Avesta also. We have the series, by the way, in our library. I have checked it. Okay. So this is also associated with Homer, the celestial drink. And in the Iranian tradition, Muhammad is known as Tretona Athriya. He is the Muhammad, the hero is the Muhammad who fought that Azid Hak. Okay? And he was a preparer of Soma, the celestial juice, for Zeus or for Ahura Mazda in Zeus in the Greek mythology. And in the Zavesta, Zenda Vesta, it is Ahura Mazda. Ahura is Asura. So Ahura Mazda is, you know, like similar to the Vedic Asura Varuna. He is the sovereign god. He is the sovereign god, Asura. And Asura, again, one more thing. Asura, we are, you know, like, we feel Asura is a demon as against Sura, the god. No, in the Rig Veda, the meaning it changes. The meaning changes. See, how you split the word, on that depends the meaning of the word, okay? Asura we split as a Sura because we know Sura. Sura is God. And therefore, a is a negative particle for us. And therefore, a and Sura, we make the word Asura. That is not God, so a demon. Dev nahi, Danav, okay? But it could be split etymologically as Asu plus Ra. Asu plus Ra, Surasva. Asu is prana. Prana is prana shakti, that is might, the vigor. And Ra is a possessive suffix. I was telling you the other day, like Madhura, Ruchira, you were asking me what are the pratyayas in Sanskrit. You know how you can coin different words by adding pratyaya to prakriti. I was telling about Jala, the, and Jala, ja. You add ja and then you can find n number of words for lotus. You just add pratyaya da to jala or synonyms of jala like nirada, varida, ambuda, toyada. You can get as many numbers of number of cloud, names of clouds. Similarly, ra is a pratyaya. Okay, so ra you add to asura, asuyukta. So one who is pranavan, that is balavan. That is Asura, mighty. So that is the meaning. And that is the meaning which is reflected in the Ahura. That is Asura. Sa becomes her, like Sindhu became Hindu. Right? Sa becoming her is a linguistic specification. Okay? It's a linguistic specification. So, coming back to this, Tretona is similar to Trita of the Rig Veda. I was telling you about the Trita Aptya story. So, Trita Aptya of the Rig Veda becomes Tretona Athriya of the Avesta. The adventure remains the same. Killing the three-headed, six-eyed dragon who can fly at times. Okay? So that remains the same. In Persian folklore also, there is, this is a story, this is again a stylization which is depicted, a typical stylization. Persian folklore has Malik Muhammad. Malik Muhammad is the name of the hero. He is the youngest of the three brothers. Again, see, there are three brothers. He is the youngest of the three brothers. And the third is deprived of his lawful share. I told you about the Trita. There is Ekata, Vita and Trita. The third, Trita, is deprived. He goes away. In fact, it's better that he did not get his lawful share. If he had got it, he perhaps could not have achieved what he did. He went out and did some exploits, did some adventure. Same thing happened to this Muhammad Malik. He was the third of the, last of the three brothers. But he also killed a dragon. He was also deprived of his lawful share. Interestingly, there was one story in Vamana Purana which I had read. I did not include it here. Maybe I'll tell you. Just verbally, in Vamana Purana, you come across a story of a Brahmana called Prabhasa, and he has two sons, Gatibhasa and one more son. Prabhasa, Gatibhasa, and one other name is there. I'm not quite sure. I don't remember it now. I'll pass it on to you later. But then this Gatibhasa was deprived of his share, and he was, you know, thrown into a pit. Gartha, Garte, Gartha is a pit. He was thrown into a pit and his brothers left him to die there, you know, of starvation and all that. But then he came out and he did the adventure. And he did the adventure. He killed one demon called Dhundhu. Dhundhu. Now again, this Dhundhu is a very interesting name. Dhu is a verb again. Dhu, dhunoti, that is to shake vigorously. Hilana, jor jor se hilana. Vigorously shaking. But he is connected with drought because he is like the controller of the sandy region, the arid region. So again, there is something, you know, that he has made everything arid because he has amassed some treasure, some water. And this Gatibhasa killed him. And the story is similar to like the Bali and Vamana story. Vishnu comes in the dwarf formation as a Batu to Bali Raja, okay, as a Vamana to Bali King, and asks for 3 strides. Okay, Trivikrama. That's why Trivikrama becomes the name for Vishnu. Trivikrama, long strides like this. Okay, Trivikrama. So, this also, this Gatibhasa asked 3 steps for Dhundhu, from Dhundhu. And similarly, as the Vamana did, you know, in one step he covered the entire Prithvi, the another step he covered the entire mid region and the heaven. And where is the place now? Where do I put my third step, third stride? And that's when he kicked off Dhundhu and kicked him so far that he was not to be seen later anymore. Interestingly, this story's version, and I told you there are various interpretations and versions of this story. Okay. The first slide, the introductory slide was various interpretations and versions of this. In this story, we have Kuvalashva and Brihadashva. Again, 2 names, you know, Brihadashva. Killing the demon Dhundhu and getting the name Dhundhumara because they killed Dhundhu. As Indra got the name Vritrahan because he killed Vritra. These Brihadashva, he got the name Dhundhumara. Interestingly, why I'm telling you Brihadashva is Dhundhumara? Interestingly, in Avesta, we have Bhadraspa, that is Bhadrashva, Brihadashva, killing a dragon and releasing water. Bhadraspa, like Jamaspa, there are these names. And Aspa is nothing but Ashva. Jamaspa, Jama is Yama. Jamshet we have. Jamshet. Okay, that is Yama. That is Yama. So we have so many commonalities, especially in the Rigveda and Avesta. There are so many parallel, you know, the names, the functions, everything is so very common. They belong to the same origin. From here they migrated to Persia later on. Maybe Saptasindhu was the origin of the civilization. And from there, some migrated westward, some migrated eastward. And that's how the civilization spread all across. Okay? The Indian civilization spread all across. It's not as the other people say that they have come from other places to India. From India, the Saptasindhu region. Because Saptasindhu is so old. From Saptasindhu region, they have migrated. There is a migration, but not inward. It's outward. Outward migration. Anyhow, so this Jamaspa, Bhadraspa, they are related to Ashva. So Ashva is a very common thing. I mean, you know, if you have a comparative mythological scenario in your mind, then you can easily connect these loose threads and just Sutre Manigana Iva, you know, like you can bind them in one common thread, all these different stories. So this Malik Muhammad, the youngest of the 3 brothers, he killed a dragon, released water, and he married a maiden who was held captive in a fort. Now this interestingly becomes the folk story material. Any prince going somewhere, Saat Samandar Paar, like, you know, the typical fairy tale thing, Saat Samandar Paar, and then he is held by some witch, some person with a urta galicha and all that thing. you know, the flying carpet or the ring which can make you invisible. All these fairy tale elements, they crept in later on. So this is a typical for fairy tale or folk tale element which we commonly find. Generally, a princess or similar high ranking nobility is saved from a dragon, either a literally dragon or a demonic figure looking like a dragon, and she is saved by the virtuous hero. Then she marries him, her savior. Okay, she marries her savior. So this has become the common structure and very popular all over the world, and many folk stories follow this pattern. So this is the pattern. The dragon killed by a hero with something. Okay, like it could be vajra, it could be something else. Now what is the symbolism in all that? See, these are all stories and stories. This is not just a storytelling class, right? we are having this class not just to tell stories. There has to be some motive behind the stories. We saw various interpretations, various versions, not only in the Indian mythology, but the other mythologies as well, the Iranian, the Greek, and the Mesopotamian mythology. But there has to be some symbol behind this. One was a natural phenomena, as we said. It's a natural phenomenon, and it is metaphorically described in the form of a story to make it more interesting, like a heroic thing. Other thing is, what does dragon really symbolize? The dragon, maybe this is just an interpretation. There could be many other interpretations. This is one of the interpretations, I would say. The dragon symbolizes chaos or disorder or terror, trouble, threat to the people, their belongings. Nobody can thrive in such an atmosphere if there is chaos, chaotic condition. Though like in Ramayana, Rama advises Bharata why he should go back to Ayodhya and rule. Bharata has come all the way to take Rama back. Rama says, I can't follow you because I have to obey the order of my father, right? But you also can't, you know, detach yourself from the kingdom. You have to go and rule, because what are the repercussions and what are the consequences of a kingless state? There will be chaos and there will be matsyanyaya prachalet. Matsyanyaya, a big fish eating a small fish. So that is matsyanyaya. So that is in Ramayana also. So what we want to do is remove that chaotic condition and keep everything in lawful, orderly, structured pattern of a society for a social security. This is the need for the social security as such. And therefore it symbolizes terror. The dragon, I feel, it symbolizes terror and threat to the beings and their belongings. And killing the dragon therefore becomes a necessity. Killing the dragon and re-establish the law and order in the society becomes a necessity. It's very, very essential. Somebody has to come forward and do it. So who comes? A deity, a mortal man. A mortal man comes forward, and later on he is deified, as I'm saying. Indra is one such example. He is the hero of the heroes. He is the Vedic hero, the greatest of the Vedic heroes. And he has fought not only against Vritra, but then there are number of enemies like Namuchi and others he has fought against. Okay. And then he has tried to establish law and order in the society. So the names may change, the places may change, and yet the primary motive remains the same. The primary motive is re-establishing the law and social order. You know, that is the primary motive. And it is, I feel, now this could be the any mortal hero riding his horse and killing the dragon who is lying below this. This picture is there. You can find the dragon and the hero umpteen numbers of comic books. And there are umpteen numbers of games. In fact, I wanted to insert a game and, you know, just let you know that this story, as old as 10,000 years from the Rigveda story, this is still now prevalent in one form or the other. Maybe not in the form of a story. In Amara Chitra Katha, we have. In Amara Chitra Katha, we have Indra and Vrutra fight. Okay? And then there are so many games the children play now. There are n number of games you can just Google out. Okay? So, this I feel. Now, this was the hero and the hero riding a horse. And this is Apollo killing the Hydra. Apollo killing the Hydra. And this is found on a pot. This is a depiction on a pot. This is the pot. What I feel symbolically, if dragon symbolizes chaos, then there has to be order. And what is the order we saw in the Rigveda? It is Rita. And what is Rita? Rita we saw on three levels it works. A cosmic level, then the terrestrial level in the form of sacrifice, the yajna, and in the psychic level as our own conscience. Sometimes our conscience brings us back to the righteous path. When you want to deviate, you know, sometimes in the fit of anger, some impulse, we want to do so many other things which are not good. But our own conscience will bring us back. So, and therefore, Rita is the most important figure. It's a pivotal, central point of the Rigveda around which all the hymns of the Rigveda, they just revolve. And as I told you, Rita is in the custody of Asura Varuna. He is called Ritavan. And there is another deity, Usha. I told you, the early dawn. She is called Ritavari. Indra, mightiest god he may be of the Veda, but he is never associated with Rita. He is an officer. He is an executor. He is controlled by Asura Varuna. So Asura is the sovereign. He is called as Samrat. Indra is Raja. Not a Samrat. So Indra is Raja. He executes the orders of Asura Varuna. So Asura Varuna is the sovereign. And his main thing is to look after the law and order prevails everywhere. You know. And that he does. He gets it done through other people. Indra is one such officer, the executor of Rita. So ultimately, we come to the concept of Rita, the cosmic order by mortal heroes, which are later on deified. So when, like for example, Shivaji Maharaj in the medieval history of Maratha, he did so many good things to establish law and order that he is deified. There is a temple of Shivaji. There is a temple of Shivaji. There are temples of actors also, I don't know, but then see, this is how the deification, the process of deification starts. So he is an Aryan hero who has fought and who has defeated many demons and got rid of the threat, their tyrannical kingdom and whatnot, their tyranny. And he released the people from all sorts of troubles and tried to reestablish law and order. So that is the work of a true king, and that Indra has been doing it. So I think this is the symbolism of this, and so that's the end of this narrative. But I would like you to go through some such stories. Interestingly, I get some feedback from other viewers, you know, that we want some lecture on Subhashitas and this and that. Because I referred to Subhashitas in my first lecture, Management and Subhashitas, and I got a long mail from one of the viewers, you know, that this is a very fascinating topic and why don't you do something on Subhashitas in a class. So maybe you can come up with some such stories, you know, which are related to this Indra-Vritra fight, and then we can incorporate that and see the symbolism of that in some other class. Okay? So I think I will end with this. Om Purnamada పూర్ణమిదం పూర్ణాత్ పూర్ణముదచ్యతే పూర్ణస్య పూర్ణమాదాయ పూర్ణమేవావశిష్యతే. ఓం శాంతి శాంతి శాంతి. హరిః ఓం శ్రీ గురుభ్యో నమః. హరిః ఓం. ధన్యవాదాలు.